Dear listeners, good evening once again. You are welcome to PRZ 109.2 FM, and you are welcome to Perspective, the program designed to help you live your best life, whatever that may mean to you. And my name is Emmanuel Utomi. I want to say thank you for joining me. And for those who are joining this discussion for the first time, I will do a quick recap of some of the things we've been talking about for the past few weeks. So far this month, we have been discussing the topic planning for success. And we have been asking this very question: what will you experience by December of this year that will make you declare this year successful? And I'll ask that question again. So for you, my dear listener, what will you experience by the December of this year that will make you declare that this year has been a success? I mean, as far as you're concerned, what would progress look like for you? And you know, last week we were looking at the topic of vision. And we said that vision is the mental or spiritual picture of a desired goal. It's the mental equivalent of what you want in life. You see, everything in life, like we said last week, is created twice. That is, before anything is achieved physically or materially, it is first captured and created, and then achieved in the mental or spiritual state. So, for you, what are those ideas? What are those visions that you have? We said having a vision is very critical to becoming successful in any field of human endeavor. Now, did you know that the most successful world-class athletes or golf professionals visualized either their race or golf shots before beginning, before even taking a shot? We know of professional athletes who would run that race with their eyes closed and in their mind's eye before they start. These were some of the ways that they prepared for the tasks ahead. And in the same way, I'm saying, for you, what are you preparing for yourself for your future? You know, it's actually interesting that even God himself is a God of vision. If you read the book of Genesis, God himself applied the same principle to Abraham. So on a few occasions, God would ask Abraham to come out of his tent and say to him, "Count the stars in the skies and count the sands in the seashore." He says, "For as numerous as these stars and sands are," he says, "so numerous shall your descendants be." What God was doing to Abraham was actually getting him to have a vision of the future that he, God, was preparing for him. And see, and another example we can find of this same thing in the scriptures, and I'm going to read to you the book of Deuteronomy chapter 8. And if you would listen, I'm going to read it from the Message translation. I'm going to read Deuteronomy chapter 8 from verse 6 to 10. And it says, "So it's paramount that you keep the commandments of God, your God. Walk down the roads he shows you and reverently respect him. God is about to bring you into a good land, a land with brooks and rivers, springs and lakes, streams out of the hills and through the valleys. It's a land of wheat and barley, of wines, of vines and figs and pomegranate, of olives, oil and honey. It's land where you will never go hungry. Always food on the table and a roof over your head. It's a land where you get iron out of rocks and mine copper from the hills. Now, verse 10 says, after a meal, satisfied, bless God, your God, for the good land he has given you. I'm going to read another portion of that scripture again. It says, it's a land of wheat and barley, of vines and figs, of pomegranate, of olives, oil, and honey. It says, it's land where you will never go hungry. Always food on the table and roof over your head. This was God, through Moses, placing an advert, giving the children of Israel a vision of where he wanted to take them, of where he was taking them. God was building a deep-seated desire within the children of Israel of a destination that was better than where they found themselves. And one of the main reasons God was doing that was because he knew that if that desire was strong enough within the people of Israel, they would go for it. They will aspire to it. Now, these same techniques are being used today on every single one of us. Do you realize that till today, organizations use the same techniques? Do you realize that for everyone, and this is actually ironic, for anyone living in London, I bet it is impossible to go one day or 1 week or, you know what, I dare say 1 month without seeing or receiving any information on how to invest your resources, your finance, or an information on personal development. So it is possible in this city to go for this much period without getting any information on how to invest or on how to develop yourself. But do you realize that it is practically impossible to go one day within this same environment without being bombarded by adverts and information on things to spend your money on? Think about it. Every time you and I go out, every time we watch the TV, every time we look at our phone, we look at an app, every single time we're out there, something somewhere is being displayed in front of us asking us to buy. Buy now, pay later. It is the same technique of placing this thing in front of you, because it is clear that once you continue to see it, it's just a function of time. In fact, you know what? I dare say that for this simple reason, and please do listen to me. It says, your life will consistently move in the direction of what dominates your mind most. It will consistently move in the direction of the things that you think about most of the time. And this is one of the main reasons why some people have become compulsive spenders in this society. You see, when all you keep seeing day in and day out is buy this, buy that, pay later, or pay at a discount, get this. After some time, your mind begins to go in that direction. And once the mind goes in that direction, that's it. Action follows. So vision in the life of a person cannot be overemphasized. It cannot be overemphasized in any way, shape, or form. And please, you know what? I am not here to help you decide if the way you live your life is right or wrong. But what I'm simply trying to point out is that from the very foundations of the earth till now, this technique has been successfully used. It is time tested. And I want you to recognize and for you to use it to help you achieve what you desire the most in life. If you can see it, you can achieve it if you know how to go for it. You see, some of us already have phones that we use, mobile phones that we already use. But when you watch those adverts about phones, the new technology, what tends to happen is that you watch those adverts, you see the billboards over and over again. Then what happens is that for some reason, you develop this strong desire to buy a new phone. Now, I do realize that for some of us, we may not even be using up to 20% or even 50% of the capacity of the phone that we have at the moment. Yet, because a vision has been clearly sold to us over and over again of the new and improved version of our current phone, what happens is that we now tend to follow it. We now tend to desire to get it. See, understanding how that desire is formed, how it is driven, and how that desire actually now becomes an addiction can be very helpful, particularly if you intend to apply to help you achieve goals in specific aspects of your life. So what if you could develop an addiction to becoming successful in certain fields? What will you do? You see, if you want to live a better quality of life, it starts with you consistently seeing that better quality of life internally. You just have to know where you are headed as a person. And I'm going to repeat that again. If you want to live a better quality of life, it starts first with you consistently seeing that better quality of life internally. And it's only then that you can move in that direction. Do you realize that no matter how skilled an archer or a shooter is, if I blindfold that shooter and I spin that shooter around maybe 3 to 10 times and I put it and I hang a target somewhere else, anywhere, it may be practically impossible for that shooter to hit the mark. Why? Because he or she cannot see what the target is. But if you take the blindfold off and you point the shooter in the direction of that target, chances are that they will hit that target. You see, living life without a vision is like being blindfolded and spun around 10 times and told to head in the right direction when we don't even know what the right direction is. So those are some of the things we've talked about in the past. That is how we've defined vision. And today, we will be looking at how to develop a vision. Now, I'm not talking about just having any one of vision, but I'm talking about how to develop a vision, an effective vision that would be addictive, that would be specific, that you would have a strong desire to pursue. Now, for some of us, we must have come through or come across or watched this popular children's story, Alice in Wonderland by Lewis Carroll. And in that story, the character Alice ends up in this magical world. And on one of her adventures, she finds herself at a fork in the road. I mean, a point where the road she was on actually splits into different parts. And when she gets to that point, apparently she became confused, not knowing what to do. And at that point, she looks up at the trees that were present, and on one of the trees was the chestnut cat. And it was apparent to the chestnut cat that Alice may be at sea as to what to do next. Then the chestnut cat asked Alice a question, and this was the question. The cat said, "Where are you going?" Now, it was as though Alice didn't even hear the question, because what Alice said next was to the cat, he said, "Which way should I go?" And then the cat turned to Alice and said, "Well, the way you should go depends on where you want to go." So the cat said, "Where are you going?" And Alice says, "I don't know." And the cat looked at Alice and said, "Then it doesn't matter which way you go." You know what? What the cat was saying to Alice was very simple. If you are not clear, if you don't know where you are going, then any road would lead you there. If you don't know where you're going, if you have no clue as to where you're headed in life, then what difference does it make which road you go? My dear listener, I'm asking you the same question. Where are you going? You see, if you cannot answer this question for any aspect of your life, then what you do or do not do makes no difference. In the absence of a clearly defined vision, time and actions are meaningless. You see, this is so important, I'm actually going to repeat it again. The only thing that gives time and action their importance and meaning is when they are targeted towards some specific goal or outcome. I'm going to share a story with you about myself. You see, I was born into a very loving home. My parents were very loving, and they provided for me everything that they possibly could. But you see, my parents were not educated. So, as far as they were concerned, while they desired to give me all that they wanted, that they felt was the best in life, what they could give me was limited, particularly in terms of education. So for me, the only reason why I went to primary school was because everyone my age was going to primary school. And I went to secondary school because everyone my age was going to secondary school. Actually, growing up, one of the questions I dreaded the most answering was, "What do you want to become when you grow up?" I never had an answer for that question. You see, for the first 33 years of my life, I lived without a vision. I was going nowhere. None of my actions, as far as concerned, made any difference. I was living aimlessly. In fact, I remember being in secondary school, and when it was time to choose subjects, I think I was the only one that said I wasn't going to choose English as a subject. That's interesting, because I didn't know that English was compulsory. I thought it was an optional one. I thought it was an elective. But by the age of 33, when I had hit rock bottom, I realized that there was need for me to change. Because suddenly I realized that there had to be more to life than what I was going through. Because at that time, I started to fail at the most important things in life. Then one day I asked myself a question. What sort of life would I want to live? And when I came up with the answer to that question, I made one decision, and that decision was to pick up a book and read for 1 hour every day, in this particular field. And that is what I did. And within the space of 7 years, I was absolutely transformed. The transformation was total and absolute. The person that I was at age 33 was way different from who I was when I got to 40. At least that gives you an idea of how old I am. And I'm older than 40 by now. Now, what are some of the ways that you can, what are some of the techniques that you can employ, that you can engage to build an effective vision? I will remind you that you are still listening to Perspective on PRZ 109.2 FM. And you are on Perspective, the program that is designed to help you live your best life. Whatever that best life might mean to you. And yes, I am Emmanuel Utomi. So I'm going to share with you two simple techniques on how to build an effective vision. But these quick techniques are based on the questions we've asked earlier. And this is the question. When your life eventually becomes everything you want it to be, what will be in it? Now, I want you to think about that question for a few seconds. When your life eventually becomes everything you would want it to be, what will be in it? You see, in order to effectively answer this question, there is need for you to break your life up into its key aspects. For example, consider your life in terms of your career, in terms of your health, in terms of your relationships, in terms of your finance, and if you're into ministry, in terms of your ministry, whatever that ministry might be to you. And there are a few other aspects that you can discuss your life, I mean, divide your life into. And then I want you to ask yourself that same question. So, for example, if we were considering your career, you would be asking yourself this question. When your career eventually becomes everything you would want it to be, what will be in it? What will it look like? You know, I want you to write this question down. When your career, when your finance, when your relationship, when your health becomes everything you want it to be, what will be in it? Take out time and write this down. And I mean, take out quality time to answer this question. You might be amazed at what you could come up with. And what you're likely to come up with would be a holistic picture of what that career would be. But remember, we're trying to plan for this year. So I'd want you to pick a certain aspect of the answers that you come up with when you're finished writing, and ask yourself, that when this year comes to an end, what would I have achieved in those aspects of my life that would make me crown this year successful? You see, I'm going to take you back to the Bible again. And in John chapter 13, verse 35, Jesus uses the same example. And he says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, when you show love one to another. So it means the greatest and the best way that Jesus gave us of how to decide your success as a Christian, as his disciple, it's in the quality of love. It's in showing love to one another. And the love Jesus talks about is described for us in 1 Corinthians 13. So there is a basis and a measure for deciding and for describing what love is and how to be successful as a disciple. So that is the first technique. Now I'm going to give you a second technique on how to build or to develop an effective vision. I want you to realize that you need to be able to view your life from a physical perspective. That is your life from various angles as a human being. Realize that as a human being, there are many aspects to who you are. And what success would mean in every aspect of your life may be different. And I'm going to use myself as an example. For example, all right, I'm a husband to my wife. I'm a father to my daughter. I'm a brother to my siblings. Where I work, I'm a colleague to my co-workers. At the moment, I'm a radio program host. I'm a teacher to my students. I'm a companion to my friends. I have a body. At least everyone does. I have a career. I serve God. Now, the list of who I am as a human being is endless. But realize that what I need to do to be classified as successful by my wife is not the same things I need to do for my daughter or any other person to classify me as successful. They're just different. The things I need to do to remain good in my health may not be the same things I need to do to remain successful in my career. So, it all starts with you clearly defining for yourself where you would like to be as an individual in every aspect of your life. My dear listener, I want to challenge you to take out quality time this week to write these visions for each aspect of your life. And please write, because writing is actually thinking on paper. Research has been carried out over and over again to buttress the fact that only 3% of the average population actually takes out time to plan on paper. But those 3% end up achieving over 97% more than every other person who does not write down their plans on paper. I want to thank you for listening to me today. You know what? I'd like to pray before I leave, because I've realized that without God, we can only try so much. So dear listeners, you pray, and I hope you plan, you put these things plans to test. I pray that the God that we serve will help you through this week, that you will have testimonies to share about what you've listened to today. I pray for your family, for those going through heartaches and pains, that the God of grace and mercy will step into those situations and glorify his name in your families. I pray this in Jesus' name. And until we meet again next week, God bless you. And remember, you can live your best life. Thank you. You can be a man.
Good evening, ladies.